Okay, good morning, everyone. My name is Robin Agin, and I teach history, Latin American history, here at the University of Manitoba. And it's a pleasure for me to introduce Dr. Julia Buxton today to you. Julia is professor of comparative politics at the School of Public Policy and senior research associate at the Central European University. She's a specialist on Latin America and an expert on Venezuela. She received her PhD and her master's degree from the London School of Economics on comparative politics. She has worked on, and she's an expert on democratization and transition processes, post-conflict recovery, and conflict analysis. Before her appointment at the Central European University at Budapest, she had taught in the United Kingdom, at Kingston University, at the London School of Economics, and she led also the Venezuela program at Georgetown University in the Edmund Walsh School of Foreign Service. So she has a long list, I'm not going to mention everything, she has a very long list of academic publications and commission policy briefs on her areas of expertise, drug policies, international development, and more to the point for the presentation today, on the Venezuelan Bolivarian Revolution, as expressed by the movement initiated by the late and former president of Venezuela, Hugo Chavez Frias, in the late 1990s. Dr. Buxton has published book chapters, journal articles, and policy papers on Venezuela. I'm going just to mention a couple of them, of these chapters, just to give you an idea. One of them, South America, Peace Operations and MINUSTAH, the view from Venezuela. Another one, Understanding Participatory Processes, in a book on participation and politics in Venezuela's Bolivarian Democracy. Another one, European Perspectives on Hugo Chavez, Bolivarianism in Venezuela, as Venezuela's post-crisis alternative. And I could go on and on. It's a long, but if you go to her page, I invite you, you'll see a humbling list of publications. So, and I think it's very fitting, just to introduce the topic, that we are talking about Venezuela as we speak. Venezuela has an important, the Venezuelan revolution has an important place in what became known as the left tide, the pink tide, or however you want to call it, that began in the 1990s in Latin America. Some people argue that it began with the Zapatista rising in 1994 in Chiapas, in Mexico. Other people point out that it was actually the movement led by Hugo Chavez that finally went to be elected in 1998. Regardless, what is true is that Venezuela played a major role in the reactions against neoliberalism in Argentina, neoliberalism that had begun, you know, being implemented slowly in the 1950s, 60s, but certainly by the military dictatorships in the 70s, peaking precisely in the 1990s. So, in a way, Venezuela was the open, the path, you know, to many of the other left-wing or center-left, depending where you look at it, Latin America in the late 1990s and early 2000s, that made significant inroads in many areas. And I would say in Latin America there are many interesting experiments that happened, you know, in reaction to neoliberalism. In many ways, Venezuela being one of them, but Bolivia being another one that I would want to call your attention to, the movement by Evo Morales. That has made incredible inroads in creative alternatives, you know, to capitalist development. So in any case, and it's very fitting that we talk about Venezuela today. As we know, Venezuela, the Venezuelan Bolivarian Revolution has had different stages, processes. We are at a kind of crossroad at this moment, and I think that it's more than appropriate to hear what Dr. Buxton has to tell us. Okay, so please join me in welcoming Dr. Buxton to this presentation.
Thank you very much. I'll start with the question everybody begins with, which is, can you hear me? Yes, good, okay. Thank you very much for having me. Obviously, I would like to thank Radhika and Alan and everybody who invited me to come here. It's the first time I've been to Winnipeg, and it's been a revelation, so it's been a great opportunity, so thank you so much. And I would in particular like to thank Glenn, who has been wonderful in looking after myself and my colleagues and has been there whenever we've needed Glenn. So thank you so much, Glenn. It's been wonderful having you. Also to say that it's great being at a conference that brings together people who work in academia, people who work in activism. We don't have enough conferences like this, so I think it's been a very valuable opportunity to hear different perspectives and bring people together. I wondered yesterday if there was such a phenomenon as death by PowerPoint. So when I went back to the hotel last night, I decided to remove a lot of the narrative, the text from my slides. And really what I'm going to be trying to do is talk you through my understanding of the situation in Venezuela, largely based on photographs and imagery. It's a very personal story also to a great extent, so I've tried to weave through my experience of working on Venezuela for the last 25 years. I'm aiming to try and get finished by 10 o'clock because I know that the session's due to finish at 10:30 and people, I expect, will have some contributions that they would like to make on Venezuela, not only in terms of anything I might say today, which I acknowledge is somewhat under-theorized and perhaps contentious, but also because, as Radhika is leading at the moment, an effort, an attempt to try and get some mobilisation together around the current situation in Venezuela. So to begin this and to frame this discussion, it is obviously crucial to say that Venezuela is currently living through a particularly perilous moment. Now, Venezuela has been on a perilous moment for many years now. We are in a constantly perilous moment. But I think we are in a particularly difficult current situation for reasons that I will come to at the end. The minute you see Donald Trump tweeting on the Venezuela situation, accompanied by Lilian Tintori, who is the wife of one of the opposition leaders, Leopoldo Lopez, it really speaks volume now about the urgency of the situation and the threats that Venezuela is facing. Down here at the bottom corner, there is a tweet, because obviously if you really want to know what's going on in the world these days, you have to follow Twitter rather than newspapers. So in 160 words, we can see here the position of Luis Almagro, who is the General Secretary of the Organization of American States, who last week has convened a committee to investigate crimes against humanity by the current Venezuelan government. This is a very difficult situation, and over the last week we have seen new US legislation against Venezuela, more sanctions, and Canada has also moved into a position by the side of the United States as an obstacle, in my view, to efforts towards dialogue led by the Pope, who in the view of the opposition is a communist. So, despite the perils of the current moment, I think it is really important to be critical in our reflections of Venezuela. And I think the real problem with Venezuela is that every time we have arrived at a point where we've needed to have discussion about the process and discussion about the direction, there is always an external threat or an internal threat which forces us into a position of defense of the Bolivarian Revolution. And as a result of this, I think we've had a rather limited engagement with some of the complexities and contradictions of what Venezuela has experienced over the last 17 years. My main argument today is that Venezuela has traditionally been framed as having a highly exploitative economic relationship with the United States. Venezuela has been very, very close to the United States for over a century, but in particular since the exploitation of Venezuela's oil reserves, really starting around 1912, 1915. And the history of Venezuela has been one of enormous debt and high levels of oil dependence, for reasons that I'm sure we'll discuss later on. It's a country which has historically been characterized by high levels of corruption, of violence, and of insecurity, and particularly of inequality and informalization. And it's a country, additionally, which has had a long-standing, and I'm going to go back through history to look at this, of politicized and inefficient bureaucracy. So where is Venezuela now? And I'm afraid here is my argument, that very little has actually changed. Venezuela still has an exploitative bilateral economic relationship, and the only thing really that has changed here has been the person or the country which is doing the exploitation of Venezuela. I'm disappointed to hear that, unfortunately, our Chinese colleagues have left, because I will be putting forward quite a forceful critique of China's position and operations in Venezuela. But I do think, nonetheless, that we have a very important period of time in Venezuela, and I would date this around 2002 to 2006, 2007, where some extraordinary things were happening. But the real problem was issues around sustainability, and the fact that these were largely driven by favourable external circumstances, which I think have sadly changed quite dramatically, but also oil export revenues. As I said, this is a very personal journey for me. Last year I was contacted by New Left Review, who said, could you please write for us the obituary of the Bolivarian Revolution? And I hadn't really conceptualized what's going on in Venezuela as requiring an obituary. And this invitation really provokes a bit of a dark period for me. In one of the sessions I was in yesterday, we were talking about dark periods of reflection. Because it was very difficult for me to write about Venezuela, because I felt such a high level of personal involvement, because I have so many friends and colleagues in Venezuela. So it's very difficult for me to reflect on, to the extent that I actually couldn't write this piece, and fortunately the editors of New Left Review came to my house and interviewed me, because I just found it so difficult to put into words how I was feeling. But since that time, I'm kind of groping towards understanding that I have assumed what I would probably call a position which is very much in line with a critical Chavista perspective. So this was the New Left Review article, but also the key thing I think is that I have really tried, since my engagement in Venezuela, to also be involved in diplomatic initiatives and official initiatives around Venezuela and the Bolivarian process. And I've served as an electoral observer in the country 6 times, and I think Venezuela has made tremendous progress in moving towards open, transparent, democratic processes, and election processes in particular. But this has been hugely underestimated and manifestly denied by the international community, which continues to highlight issues around electoral fraud and electoral corruption as a way of delegitimizing this process. So what I have attempted to constantly do is be engaged in what's going on in the country. Now, the other thing as well is that actually writing on Venezuela, as I've discovered, is very, very difficult. I normally focus on things such as open democracy, where I have pointed out the basic facts that actually Hugo Chavez is very popular. Throughout the 2000s, this was constantly denied. I'm not a huge fan of the concept of populism, because I think this has been quite detrimental to understanding what's happening in Venezuela, and particularly during the Chavez period. But what I've also learned from trying to engage and publish widely on Venezuela is that you do face intense abuse. And I'll come back to this later on when I talk about counter-revolution. The story of my last 10, 15, 20 years of working on Venezuela is that there have been people in the opposition movement who have written to my boss, who've written to anybody I've been working for, who have denounced me as a perpetrator of war crimes along with the Bolivarian regime. If I do anything on the BBC World Service, I return home to emails denouncing my support for totalitarianism. And I think that this is a real effort to shut down the space for rational discussion on Venezuela. And I think particularly in academic circles, and maybe what again, I can talk about this later on, it's highly detrimental to intellectual inquiry and academic freedom. So my journey in Venezuela then began in the early 1990s, when I had just finished my master's at the London School of Economics, and my work was very much focusing on the role of trade unions in democratization processes, and I was comparing Latin America with Eastern Europe. And when I thought about doing a PhD, I was particularly keen to look at Mexico, because at that point in time, early 1990s, Mexico was the place to be doing really radical, innovative research, and particularly in terms of understanding the pushback against neoliberalism. And my PhD supervisor said, I don't want you to go to Mexico. If you want to do a PhD with me, I think you should go to Venezuela. Which was quite a heartbreaking thing to hear at the time, when you feel all radical and activist, because Venezuela was something of an unknown quantity. And it's also quite a difficult country to study because of the oil economy and the rentier dynamics of the state. But nevertheless, under his very strong urging, and I do mention this because I think sometimes the way we go academically and intellectually is influenced by people who we don't really acknowledge enough in our work. So I went to Venezuela. I was given the intense methodological advice by my supervisor, and for any of you who are working in academia, methodology, as you know, whether you're quantitative or qualitative, and the advice that I got from my advisor, who was a very elite Oxbridge-educated gentleman in a safari suit, was the approach I want you to take is FOFO. Is anybody here familiar with FOFO? Essentially, FOFO means fuck off and find out. And that was why I was sent to Venezuela with the FOFO approach in mind. And Venezuela was interesting at this point in time because in 1989, there had been a horrific experience in Venezuela, and this was called the Caracaso of February 1989. And during this period, there was a major popular demonstration uprising against a neoliberal economic package that was introduced by former President Carlos Andres Perez, who's pictured down here at the bottom of the screen. And this popular rebellion was brutally and violently suppressed by the Venezuelan state, and particularly through the deployment of the Venezuelan armed forces. And that in turn triggered a rebellion within the armed forces from the junior ranks, who thought this was absolutely outrageous that the proud Bolivarian military forces had been used to suppress their own people. And this really is the beginning of the political career of Hugo Chavez, who you see at the top there in the picture with the other leaders of the attempted coup in 1992. Now, the coup failed and Chavez went to prison. But what you will probably be aware of is that Chavez then really began to unravel through this coup attempt this system which was known as Vene Democracia. Very briefly, because Sunday morning at 9:30 is not really the time for going through Venezuela's recent history, Venezuela was very late in coming to democracy. It wasn't until 1958 that the country moved away from military dictatorship here under Juan Vicente Gómez. And so Venezuela had a pacted transition. And in this respect, we have the emergence of two dominant parties. It was a dominant two-party system. Some of the academic analysts refer to this as partidocracia. And this was Acción Democrática, or AD, and COPE, which was the Christian Democrat Party. And in 1958, these two bitter rivals put aside their differences and, through a pact, agreed that essentially they would share power. And this power-sharing agreement brought into it the military, the church, the private sector, represented through an organization called Fede Camaras, and also the trade union movement. So this was, in effect, the creation of a very clientelistic framework of politics. So it was only through the official unions that you would be recognized as a worker, and it was only through the official private sector organization, Fede Camaras, that you were able to access government and political representation. This is all very important because it really kind of links to my full circle argument on Venezuela. Now, the way that these two parties, AD and COPE, stabilized Venezuela was that they essentially shared power. They shared appointments in the judiciary, they shared appointments in the electoral administration, they shared effectively positions in the state bureaucracy. So this was a power-sharing agreement. Now, this enabled Venezuela to avoid the catastrophic right-wing military interventions that we saw in countries such as Argentina and Uruguay and Brazil. And Venezuela had what we call a positive sum gain. And this was enabled by its oil export revenues. Because the oil export revenues coming into Venezuela from its oil exports was then distributed through the Venezuelan state to the parties and to their affiliated unions and organizations. So this created a positive sum gain. There was no class conflict in the way we would understand occurred in places like Brazil and Argentina. But then this began to unravel dramatically in the 1980s and in the early 1990s for a whole host of reasons, but in particular, and this is again the full circle argument, reliance on oil export revenues. And the problem was, during periods of boom economic prices, Venezuela was known as the Saudi Arabia of Latin America. It was one of the fastest growing economies in the world, massive reductions in poverty and inequality, but then oil bust. And when the price of oil exports diminished, Venezuela was left in a very, very difficult financial situation. And the way the parties sought to manage this, and this links to Kiss's keynote the other day, was through this kind of creation of a welfare state as a way of ameliorating political and class conflict. But to keep this model going, they borrowed money from overseas. So Venezuela became increasingly indebted, producing ultimately a major debt crisis by the early 1990s. Now, this gentleman down here, Carlos Andrés Pérez, he sought to deal with this through a process that I called Perestroika, because what Pérez sought to do was liberalize the economy, this kind of very neoliberal approach, but at the same time, and as a way of trying to reduce popular protest, he also opened up the political system. So he made it possible for minor parties to compete. There was processes of decentralization and processes of attempted political reform. So when I arrived in Venezuela, the country was in crisis, but there was a real breakdown of the traditional political system. Carlos Andrés Pérez himself was impeached, Chavez was in prison, and what we had was a scenario that was wide open for the emergence of non-traditional populist figures. And when I arrived in Venezuela, that non-traditional populist figure, who everybody was looking to save Venezuela, was a beauty queen. And that beauty queen was Irene Sáez. Irene Sáez had been Miss Universe, which is the inevitable qualification for holding presidential office in Venezuela. She had this, you know, wide popular appeal, so everybody was looking to Irene. Now, I had this choice of either looking at a beauty queen, she was mayor of Chacao, but by the time, you know, we can talk about looking at beauty queens in the Q&A, but I actually was more interested in what was happening on the left. And in Venezuela, I became particularly drawn to an organization that was called La Causa R. And La Causa R, which had been formed by a gentleman called Alfredo Maniero, who's photographed there, had developed this theory. It moved itself away from the traditional Venezuelan left, the socialist left, which was represented by the mass party, the movement to socialism. And Maniero's argument that was that due to the underdevelopment of the working class, because of the overwhelmingly informal nature of Venezuela, because of the specifics of Venedemocracia, there needed to be an alternative route to social change. And I emphasize social change. And the whole theory and position of La Causa R was to focus on mobilization in three key sectors. First of all, these three pillars, three legs of the stool, as Maniero called it, first of all was the attempt to build independent trade union organization. So union organization that was separate from the Punto Fijo Venedemocracia trade unions. And the focus, really, of this activity was down in Bolivar State, in the south of Venezuela, which was the center of the heavy industrial drive of the 1970s. The other main locus was the intellectuals, and the focus here was largely in Caracas. And this was about trying to change the cultural dominance of what was seen as being Yankee imperialism. Of Venezuela. So it's trying to engage in intellectuals and trying to present alternative visions of Venezuela's culture and identity and history from that which had been presented by the Punto Fijo system. And then the final leg here was the popular sectors, the massive sprawling informal economies. And you see this picture here, this really I think is emblematic of the distinctions in Venezuelan society between on the one side of the highway the wealthy and the privileged and then on the other side of the highway these mass sprawling barrios of Venezuela. And this is where La Causa R sought to mobilize. And it ran in the presidential elections, but it faced really serious challenges. Electoral fraud, and this is why looking at fraud, electoral fraud was so important to me, but also high levels of repression by the Venezuelan state, and particularly down in Bolivar. André Velasque ran, who was the candidate for La Causa R, ran for the presidency in 1993, but was really quite roundly defeated in what looked like, to my mind, one of the most fraudulent elections that Venezuela had had in the modern period. Now, going back then was that Velasquez had been essentially sidelined because of this electoral defeat, and you had this radiant, beautiful, blonde-haired, blue-eyed former Miss Universe who was taking the country by storm. And then out of nowhere, and literally, I mean out of nowhere, we had the emergence of this former leader of the coup attempt of 1992, which was Hugo Chavez after his release from prison. Now, Chavez mobilized with an organization, his Movimiento Quinta República, which was the fifth Republican movement. And what was interesting about Chavez is that he had a profound skepticism of civilian political organizations. And in particular, Chavez's skepticism related to what he saw as having been the failure of La Causa Aérea to mobilize in support of the coup attempt of 1992. So for Chavez and for Chavez's supporters in the military, central to their vision was the notion of the military having a leading role as the driving force of revolutionary change, and the perception that civilian organizations were utterly unreliable and spent all of their time arguing about left-wing positions in meeting rooms. Chavez wanted action. So Chavez mobilized around Quinta República and had this tremendous success in the presidential elections of 1998. I was in Venezuela for the British government as the election observer, and it was an extraordinary experience to see all of these votes coming in for Chavez. And when it was very clear that Chavez had won, Saez, the beauty queen, kind of killed her election campaign at the end, because as Chavez rose up, she became increasingly right-wing and neoliberal and tried to look for agreements with Aedi and Coppe. And then, arguably the most fatal aspect of her campaign, when asked who one of her heroes or role models was, she said, Margaret Thatcher. However, Chavez was citing his hero as Tony Blair. So, Chavez steams through these elections as Irini Saez collapses, and what we have then is the movement towards this new phase of Venezuelan history, which is the effort to deconstruct the Fourth Republic and build the Fifth Republic. Now, this is where I think we need to pay a little bit of attention to who was influencing Hugo Chavez, because what we're seeing currently from both the political left and the political right is, in my view, this effort to rewrite Venezuelan history and to rewrite Chavez. And in particular, from both left and right, we have this idea that Chavez was, since the emergence of his political career, a committed Marxist. I completely disagree. It's very difficult. And what prompted me with this conference, I went back and was reading some of these original interviews with Chavez, with people like Farruko Sesto, who were around Chavez at the time. And you really are struck by the emphasis and the influence of Latin American thinkers and writers, and also European, but European kind of mainstream democratic socialist thinkers. So I would say that when Chavez first came to power in 1999, the kinds of main intellectual influences that we see for Chavez was, first of all, Simon Bolivar, the leader of the Venezuelan independence movement, who had also liberated other countries in the region, Bolivia, Ecuador. And Bolivar's argument in the mid-19th century was that these new countries of Latin America had to unify and defend themselves against not the Spanish and not the rampaging imperialist Brits, but instead against this new emerging power to the north called the United States. So for Bolivar, there had to be regional integration to defend the independence of Latin America. So Bolivarianism, and what Richard Gott in his wonderful book on Chavez, The Liberator, has detailed, is the influence of Bolivar and of Bolivar's own teacher, Simon Rodriguez, and also the independence leaders of Venezuela, Zamora, and all these kind of very traditional historical leaders of Venezuelan independence and nationalism movements. I would say that the other key influence on Chavez was Juan Velasco Alvarado of Peru. He was the leader of the military coup attempt in Peru in the late 1960s. And in particular, Chavez was drawn to the Peruvian military model because, unlike the right-wing militaries of Chile and Argentina, the Peruvian military saw themselves as key actors in national development. And this was profoundly influential for Chavez and his Bolivarian vision that the military had the key role in national reconstruction. Eduardo Galeano was also profoundly important, as later was Chomsky. You may have seen images of Chavez waving around Galeano's open veins of Latin America and this engagement with the historical dependency and exploitation of Latin American countries by the imperial powers. And then also Anthony Giddens and the notion of a new model of third-way socialism. So there was Tony Blair in there, there was a Tony Giddens in there, there was Simon Bolivar. Chavez was a real intellectual magpie. But the key thing is that the emphasis was not on Marxism, it wasn't on socialism, it was about building the Fifth Republic and deconstructing the Fourth Republic, the 1958 Punto Fijo model. So what we have then is this immediate first phase from around 1999 where the focus is on the following. Firstly, the overriding centrality of constitutional reform. A constituent assembly was convened, there was a redrafting of the Venezuelan constitution which was released and approved by popular referendum in 2000. There was an emphasis on participatory, or what they call protagonistic democracy, because the Punto Fijo system had marginalized and excluded and controlled popular participation. What the Bolivarian Revolution wanted to do was to build a new protagonistic model in which emphasis was instead placed not on the formal liberal institutions of the liberal democratic model, but a more Rousseauian vision of direct democracy, of community control, of community councils. So we had politics and institutions and a reconfiguring of the institutions. Every arm of the state was dominated by Acción Democrática and COPE. So they rebuilt the judiciary. They created a new judiciary, the TSJ, the Supreme Justice Tribunal. The old Electoral Commission was reframed, rebuilt. It became the CNE, the National Election Commission. The National Assembly was created out of the old Congress and Senate. The old Senate was sidelined, dissolved, and we had a National Assembly. So there was a major institutional reconfiguration. Now, the other thing that was central in terms of the Constitution and these early initiatives was also an emphasis on social policy. And here, and we see in the 2000 Constitution, new social rights written into the Constitution of the Bolivarian state. And in particular, what we were looking at here were programs that were intended to overcome the chronic inequalities, structural inequalities, marginalization, and exclusion of Venezuelan society. So there's an emphasis here on the role and responsibility of the state in education provision, in health provision, in housing provision. The social economy, and again very much influenced here for Chavez by the notion of a kind of third way, moving in and rectifying the failures of the market, there was a strong emphasis on the importance of oil sovereignty. That the Venezuelan state had lost control of its hydrocarbon resources. And this essentially followed a strategy of privatization in the state oil company PDVSA, which had been pursued in the late 80s and early 1990s under the neoliberal structural adjustment process. And as a result of this opening up and privatization of Venezuela, the view of the new Bolivarian government, the ideas of people like Bernard Momma, of Ali Rodriguez, who had been very influential in the Causa Aire, bringing the ideas of people historically like Salvador de la Plata about state ownership of hydrocarbon resources. So there was a big push to reverse the privatization and to nationalize the oil sector. And under the new constitution and under legislation that was developed by the National Assembly, the Venezuelan state had to have a maximum 51% share in any oil-related exploration activities. And linked with this, and in terms of foreign policy, the aim was to try and drive up the international oil price. And crucial to mention here is that when Chavez came to power, Venezuela was essentially producing oil at a loss. Venezuela has very dirty, heavy crude oil. It's enormously expensive to drill, and it's very difficult to refine. And it trades below the global oil price basket. But the emphasis now was trying to drive and lift up this oil price through aligning with other hawks in OPEC, such as Iran, and then trying to ensure that once you control your oil sector, you can actually maximise the revenues of your oil economy. So this was a complete repudiation of the idea that commodity-dependent countries had to actually diversify and sell or give away, privatise their natural resources. What Chavez was saying here was that we need to have sovereignty over our oil resources, but, and crucially, we do need to diversify. And we can actually use these oil revenues to effectively stimulate national development across the country. And then the final aspect here, foreign policy. Venezuela, through this model and ideas of Bolivarianism, looked to regional integration, but integration not on the basis of these competitive race-to-the-bottom free trade agreements, but instead around the ideas of collaboration and sharing each other's comparative advantage. Building new institutions, moving away from this terrible regional organization called the Organization of American States, which is simply there to be the kind of puppet of US foreign policy, to move and promote South-South development, linking up countries in the global South, and also to build a multipolar vision of the world order. So to completely move away from the unipolar dominance of the United States. So I would call this phase one of the Bolivarian Revolution. And this was really, to my mind, a progressive, broad coalition. And in particular here, you also see the military coming into politics. But the reality of this first phase of the Bolivarian Revolution is that there was very little social initiative. Okay? There wasn't a huge pro-poor agenda. The emphasis was on institutional and constitutional redesign. If we don't control the judiciary and the National Election Council, we're just going to be simply overthrown from within. So this was the primary focus. But then we move to a far more dramatic phase. And this dramatic phase is 2002, when we have the coup attempt against Hugo Chavez. This extraordinary moment in Venezuela led to, for 48 hours, this interim right-wing junta led by Pedro Carmona, who had been the president of FEDECAMARAS, which was the private sector organization that had previously been part of the formal Punto Fijo state structures. Now, this was a really interesting moment, and we can talk about this in the Q&A, but for the UK, which was, you know, everybody talks about the US being involved in this, but the British government was very much involved in this, and particularly Tony Blair, which was a shame given how much Chavez appeared to like him at the time. And we had this very embarrassing moment, as we tend to do being British, where one of our foreign ministers, a gentleman called Dennis McShane, who was subsequently sent to prison for corruption, appeared on television and said, "I'm really glad to see that Hugo Chavez has been overthrown. I never liked the fella." And then 48 hours later, Chavez was back. And Chavez was back overwhelmingly because of the mobilization of popular sectors. And there's a wonderful film that I'm sure many of you have seen called The Revolution Will Not Be Televised, when the Irish film company RTE, who had gone to interview Chavez, found themselves then trapped in the presidential palace when it was the coup attempt. So if you haven't seen The Revolution Will Not Be Televised, I strongly recommend it. So the experience of the coup attempt transformed the Bolivarian Revolution in my mind. And I would say that we actually moved from the Bolivarian Revolution to Chavismo. And this is Chavez, if you read the words of Federico Sesto, Chavez hated the term Chavismo. Because he didn't want this revolution to be about him. But I think what we see during this phase is growing popular identification. Clearly there was before, but I would say that Chavez, as the kind of central glue in this process of transformation, really becomes essential at this point. And what we see from this point onwards, whereas Chavez and, you know, during the first phase they've been a bit relaxed, constitutional reform, institutional reform, this was now a real revolutionary process. And it was aided and facilitated by the fact that the regional and the international environment was beginning to change. So in particular here, what we were beginning to see during the second phase was firstly a lift in the international oil price. which was of course connected to the fact that the United States was very distracted with its war on terror, instability in the Middle East, the oil prices rising. This means Venezuela has a real increase in revenues coming into the state, which can then be distributed into a range of initiatives, social policy initiatives, to consolidate the popular sector and really address these issues of inequality. The other key thing was there was major anti-US sentiment in the region at the time, most of the time really, obviously, but at this particular time linked to efforts to push through the free trade area of the Americas. But also, and absolutely centrally here, you had the beginnings of the pink tide. So Chavez was no longer on his own. He now found himself with, you know, regional sympathizers and empathizers and sympathizers, such as Kirchner in Argentina, Lula in Brazil, which was hugely, hugely important. And then this coalition of progressive left forces. Correa was elected in Ecuador and Evo Morales in Bolivia. So Venezuela is no longer operating, unlike today, in a deeply hostile regional environment. And this enabled major traction on key institution building initiatives. And I would also say that during this phase, Chavez becomes personally closer to Fidel Castro, and Venezuela becomes bilaterally closer to Cuba. And in particular here, as we'll see in a second, this is the beginning of the oil for doctors exchange programs. This is where Chavez, who had seen Fidel Castro as a mentor previously, but this is where this relationship becomes very, very tight, very close and very important, and where you have this increased emphasis on the necessity of the civilian military defense of the revolution. So this is a real shift. So in terms of these domestic initiatives, you're probably familiar with these, most famously the Misiones. This was a major social policy drive. It encompassed programs such as Barrio Adentro, going into the neighborhood to deliver primary and secondary health care in situ to communities which previously weren't wealthy enough to afford private health care in America, to afford private health care, and because the public health care provision in Venezuela was so utterly diabolical. So Barrio Adentro, community health provision. There was an extension of citizenship rights. The 4 million plus Colombians who had fled to Venezuela as a result of the civil conflict in their country were given citizenship, given identity cards. There was a drive to ensure that all Venezuelans had identity cards, and therefore they had access to these programs and access to voting rights. There was a shift from the old tick the box, put your thumbprint on voting system towards automated electronic voting. And all of these range of policies here, which were initiatives in education, healthcare, Bolivarian schools. It was about breakfast clubs. It was about employment programs. It was about literacy training. This was an immense period in Venezuela. And crucially, there was an emphasis on gender and recognizing that you had to be gender sensitive in your programs. It was about creating the women's bank, Ban Mujer, to enable women and also popular sectors who had no access previously to credit to be able to borrow and develop their own social and community networks and enterprises. Crucially, and this is really quite fatal, the decision is also taken to what Chavez calls turning off the spigots, oil taps, to Venezuela's traditional elite, economic elite. Very powerful five economic families who, because of the rentier nature of Venezuela's oil economy, had in effect become this domestic economic oligarchy. And the decision was taken, and Steve Elner has written extensively on this, and I strongly recommend Steve Elner's work to you, is that the Venezuelan government decided it would have to create a new loyal economic elite to drive forward the diversification of Venezuela. And this is, I would argue, the point where things start to go slightly wrong. But the key thing here is we have a mass redistribution, not just distribution, redistribution. This is very important differentiation of Venezuela's oil wealth. And also, as you can see here, this in turn impacts on inequality and poverty levels in Venezuela. I wrote a paper for the UN at the time because what was interesting was that other countries were experimenting with models of what we call CCT, conditional cash transfers, places like Brazil and Mexico with Solidaridad y Progreso. And the idea of these conditional cash transfers is that if you give money, welfare payments, to the community on the basis of them fulfilling certain requirements, taking your child to school, getting inoculated against measles. And what was astonishing about what Venezuela did was to say, actually, just CCTs is totally inadequate. There's no point having this very, very small payment if you live in a situation of chronic insecurity, if you have inadequate housing, if you don't have access to enough calories, if you can't afford to buy food, and if you haven't got an education. So actually, you've got to go further than CCTs. You've got to completely reconstruct the basic social services system. And this really was an important lesson learned for development. And I think that this was a crucial phase for Venezuela. Similarly, there was a big push now to create what was called a new geometry of power, in particular influenced by the late and much lamented Doreen Massey. And this is the idea of creating and emphasizing the role of communities as the key locus of decision making. And it was for communities to decide what their key water needs were, for example, through water committees that brought together the community and the state. It was there for communities to decide what were the health needs they required through the Barrio Adentro programs. We had a mass program of land redistribution, which was intended to enable the diversification of the economy and a reduction of Venezuela's food dependence on imports. But there was also a big push to transform the culture of the country. And in particular here, going back to what I was saying before, it was a move to recognize the indigenous identity of Venezuela, the Afro-Caribbean, Afro-Venezuelan identity, which had always been sidelined because of this big emphasis and linkage with the United States and what was seen as being this baseball Yankee culture. If you're interested in this period and this kind of cultural revolution, I strongly recommend the work of people like Naomi Schiller and Sujata Fernandez. On the regional front, major progress here, facilitated by the oil revenues. ALBA, the Bolivarian Alliance for the American Peoples, which brought together countries such as Cuba, Nicaragua, Venezuela, the Caribbean countries, Ecuador. Instead of, competing in the international economy against each other, this was about comparative advantage. If you need oil and I need flour, I'll give you oil for flour. If you need sugar, you need concrete, then we'll exchange. So this was about building a system of exchange. We also had the UNASUR organization, which was built as an alternative to the Organization of American States, excluded America, excluded Canada. And we also had initiatives such as Petro Caribe, where Venezuela here was aiming to distribute discounted oil to Caribbean and Central American countries, which were really crippled by this major surge in international oil prices. So this again was about building regional solidarities. And then because one of the perennial problems of our time is Fox News and CNN, as part of these efforts to transform the way Venezuela was portrayed externally, we have the launch of initiatives such as Telesur. International level, pushing during this phase to build a multipolar world order, major initiatives around South-South integration, really reaching out. Chavez was very active on issues around Palestine and Palestinian conflict between Israel and Palestine. Very, very sympathetic, really prioritized Palestine as being a key issue for the Venezuelan Bolivarian Revolution. Peace in Colombia. Chavez was instrumental in the peace process that today is coming off the rails in Colombia. Total rejection of the role of the United Nations in things like Haiti's Blue Helmets, the UN peacekeeping mission in Haiti led by Brazil. Why are we sending in Brazilian Blue Helmets to rebuild Haiti? Just give Haiti the facilities to rebuild itself. Okay, so really challenging the international order and the model of global governance. Building relations within OPEC, as I mentioned before, and with non-OPEC countries, those countries not in OPEC, Algeria, Russia, Vietnam, again then tying up with South-South integration initiatives. And then hydrocarbon distribution programs, using oil as a tool of petro-diplomacy. In particular, after the coup attempt against Chavez, Chavez decided that because Mr. Bush was so concerned about poverty in Venezuela, Chavez was very concerned about poverty in the United States. So Chavez, through Citgo, set up this oil distribution program with discounted heating fuel going to First Nation communities and also to geriatric communities, homes for the elderly. And also, and interestingly, and this links to Jorge's presentation the other day, the use of union attachés in Venezuela's embassies around the world. So really promoting cultural and labour integration. No idea who that fella is in that middle picture, Alan, do you know? The Mayor of London, ladies and gentlemen, the Mayor of London. and the exchange programme between Venezuela and the UK. Then, to really accelerate now, we go into a third phase. And this is when Chavez decides that Venezuela is going to start striving to build socialism of the 21st century. And this came as a bit of a surprise to very many people. You can go through all of the writings, and even if you're looking at Greg Wilper, Mike Gonzalez, Diane Raby, the lack of definition over what is socialism of the 21st century, I think, has been one of the most problematic aspects of the Bolivarian Revolution. But nevertheless, Venezuela was striving for the socialism of the 21st century during Chavez's third presidential term in 2006. Very loosely articulated, and again we'll come back to this in the Q&A, but there was a real shift here, a real kind of move towards the embrace of more arguments around needing to control the economy and have a higher role for the state in Venezuela's economy. Oil is now seen as being the motor of the revolution. Why would we diversify when actually we should be using oil as the key driver, the real way that we mobilize our domestic and international influence? So you have a process here of accelerated nationalizations. Instead of focusing only on the popular sectors, Chavez began to embrace something he hadn't really been very fond of, trade unions, building a trade union organization. Huge nationalization program with expropriation really being led from the grassroots. And you also had during this period the creation of the new Socialist Party, the United Socialist Party of Venezuela, and a big, what was seen at that time, as anti-corruption drive. So that was the third phase, and before we actually had any real idea of what socialism of the 21st century was going to be, unfortunately, Chavez died in 2013. And again, another surprising twist, his former foreign minister, Nicolás Maduro, assumes the presidency. And this is really where I think we have to be realistic about what Maduro inherited. Firstly, he inherited a catastrophically deepened dependence on oil export. Venezuela, during Chavez's government, went from relying on oil exports for about 75% of its revenues to around 92% of its revenues. What Maduro also inherited was an escalating foreign debt, which today stands at around $134 billion. What he also inherited was a very distorted economic policy. During the coup attempt of 2002, price and exchange controls had been imposed in order to reduce capital flight and to try and ensure there was distribution of food to the populous sectors, but they were retained right through. And this is the argument of people like Mark Weisbrot. There was a failure to adjust these basic tools of the macro economy. And this started to create big distortions, most particularly in the distribution of dollars. There was the official dollar exchange rate, and there was also the unofficial dollar, the black market. And those who had access to dollars were the most privileged in Venezuela. It was those with political connections. And this became, I would say, the key driver of the staggering corruption we have unfortunately seen unfurl in Venezuela. There was also a crisis of violence and insecurity. Venezuela, if you look at the UN today, in terms of homicides, is probably around the world's third most dangerous place because of its homicide levels. You cannot have a functioning participatory democracy if you can't go out in the dark. Okay, so this was a real neglect of popular security. The PSUV was very fractious after Chavez's death, and I would argue this was because in reality there had been very limited opportunities within the ruling party and the broader coalition for proper discussion and debate. And I would say in particular the almost unilateral decision to move towards socialism of the 21st century led to a hemorrhaging out of the from the party of those kind of social democratic left Chavistas. So we see this big kind of shift. The grassroots become increasingly disaffected. There's a lot of lack of real clarity over what now is the meaning of the Bolivarian Revolution, but also the perception increasingly that unless you are politically connected to the PSUV, you don't have access to dollars, you don't have access to food distribution programs. The opposition was strengthened, I'll come to them in a second, but also the other problem, and this is what I discussed in the New Left Review article, was that the misiones and all of these amazing social policy initiatives simply weren't institutionalized. What Venezuela essentially developed during this period was a parallel state. The old state wasn't dissolved and removed, it was retained. At the same time, these informal structures were built. So there was these two systems running side by side. And the real problem here, and particularly with, for example, the misiones, is, I would argue, an emphasis on quantity of provision rather than the quality of provision. There was no monitoring and evaluation. There was no proper data collection. When you're concerned about poverty and development, I'm afraid these things are important and they do matter. And the external environment was changing for Maduro. The pink tide has receded. We've seen the right wing re-elected in Brazil, in Argentina. And catastrophically, as we all know, the oil price has dropped. So I don't want to dwell on the statistics, but you can really see here the problem that Venezuela is facing now. Catastrophic fall in its GDP, horrendous fall in its oil exports, running a major budget deficit, and is facing catastrophic payments on its international debt. And this is a whole debate in itself. Should Venezuela be paying its international debt? Because what Venezuela has been doing is faithfully and loyally repaying exorbitant yields, interest rates, on its sovereign debt. Venezuela has a catastrophic, in my view, debt repayment coming up at the end of this month. Between the last week of October and the first week of November, it has nearly $3 billion in debt repayment to make. In the context of an international reserve position of around $8 billion. And the way Venezuela has been making these payments has been squeezing dramatically the consumption in the country. I hold my hand up, I also work with people through political risk, and believe me, right now, the people who most want to see Maduro stay in power are holders of Venezuela's sovereign bonds. Because the Venezuelan opposition have said if they take power, they will restructure and renegotiate the debt. That's not what international bondholders want. The reserve position has collapsed, and we have this roaring situation of inflation. Unofficial estimates now is that inflation is running at about 1,660%. We can say it's economic warfare. I've had the economic warfare argument since 1999. Economic pressures are really quite catastrophic. Huge increase in the black market value of the Bolivar. So really, this situation now is benefiting the locationally advantaged over the locationally disadvantaged. Access is increasingly predicated on political connection. And then, as you can see here, just this constant fall. And what were in the oil price? And this is, to me, the travesty of somebody who was, you know, was so enthused about what was going on during this period, this second phase, when I did believe another world was possible, and Venezuela did present this model of alternative, transformative social change, is that what we're seeing is a reversal, complete erosion of all of the gains that were made during this phase in the mid-2000s. Poverty is up, inequality is up, and these are, for me, extremely serious concerns which are simply not being addressed by government economic policy. And to give you one example of what I see as the utter stasis of policy in Venezuela, is that Venezuela has retained a massive subsidy on the domestic distribution of oil, of petroleum. Huge. The price of a litre of petroleum in Venezuela, as I'm sure you know, is cheaper than a litre of water. Who benefits from this massive subsidy? People who have very big cars. Who has very big cars? It's not the popular classes. I think that the retention of this oil subsidy is one of the most regressive distribution systems in Venezuela, and it is extraordinary to me that this has not been addressed by the government. The argument is, in 1989, when we lifted oil prices, it caused a caracazo. I simply don't buy the argument. This economic situation required that this subsidy had to be addressed. But overwhelmingly, I would say, the most calamitous situation for Venezuela right now is its relationship with China. China has emerged as being the key lender for Venezuela. Venezuela's debt to China now is in the region of $63 billion. China-Venezuela's relations, to my mind, is a mortgaging out of Venezuela's future. Now, we can all put our hands up and say, well, you know, we didn't want US exploitation, we didn't want commercial exploitation by US transnationals. All I can see right now is that has simply been exchanged by exploitation by Chinese private companies and Chinese public companies. This situation for Venezuela and the terms of the lending to Venezuela have been ruinous. Venezuela essentially negotiated its debts and lending to China at a time when the price of oil was very high. In exchange for lending, Venezuela ships oil to China. Because of the fall in the oil price, Venezuela is now having to ship three times the amount to China of its oil than had been originally agreed with China under this initial 2006 Chinese loan package. Venezuela is entirely, right now, economically dependent on China. And to read headlines like this, whether it's the National Interest, whether it's the Guardian, whether it's the Telegraph, whether it's the National Enquirer, is astonishing. This is not Bolivarian sovereignty. Should China allow the revolution to fail? Very quickly, we'll come back to this. 2 seconds, 2 minutes? I mean, no, it's Q&A. This clock's wrong, isn't it?
It's by 7.5 minutes.
The counter-revolution, completely to be anticipated, obviously to be anticipated. At least the United States has been consistent in its hostility. It doesn't matter whether you're Madeleine Albright, who refused to meet Chavez in 1997 before he was the president, or whether you're Donald Trump. The US has been remarkably consistent. Whether you're Democrat or Republican, what we have seen for Venezuela is the effort to contain what I believe was initially the threat of a good example. And we've seen this through the influence of the anti-Castro lobby, increasingly now Marco Rubio, the senator from Florida, who has moved into the vacuum of any Trump appointments, really, to the State Department. And when you're actually yearning for appointments to be made in the US State Department, that's how dire the situation really is right now in global politics. So the Beltway Network is very important. People who were previously in the Venezuelan government, went to Harvard, went to US universities, now work in American think tanks, very, very influential, privileged access to US government. And then some of the issues we've also talked about in some of our workshops, the channeling of resources to the opposition through the NED and USAID. And if you're interested in this, obviously read Ava Gollinger, whose book The Chavez Code details line by line the money that has been channeled to the opposition. A particular concern is that the whole discourse around human rights, these liberal normative values, has been used against Venezuela. Human Rights Watch, very, very early on, has been very, very critical and harsh on Venezuela, which has really kind of devalued, I think, the whole normative human rights narrative. And we've also seen Venezuela decertified for failure to comply in the war on terror and the war on drugs. And now we have a situation where individuals in Venezuela are being sanctioned. The only saving grace is that the opposition in Venezuela are completely useless. And never has there been an opposition movement that probably was so useless in the history of Latin America than the Venezuelan opposition movement. Totally divided, completely hapless, totally counterproductive interventions. And I would actually argue, and in the article I'm currently writing, really you have to understand Chavismo and the hegemony of Chavismo as a default of the failures of Venezuela's opposition. Complete shifts in its strategies, boycotts, strikes, lockouts, just a permanent cycle of strategies to undermine the Venezuelan government, but which simply failed to connect to ordinary Venezuelans. And in particular here, fake news. Okay, I would argue the Venezuelan opposition movement were the pioneers of fake news. And you can be sat in Russia, you can be sat in Iran, you can be sat in Europe, and you'll be reading, and this really began, you know, during the opposition protests 3 years ago, led by Leopoldo López, where you were seeing all of these images. You see here this image on this side here, and this is saying that, you know, this is repression of the people of Venezuela by the Venezuelan armed forces. Unfortunately, if you do a photo image search, you'll actually see that it's a picture from Argentina. Similarly, SOS, Venezuela, repression, repression, and a picture of students being dragged away, but actually the picture is from Chile. Similarly here, awful Venezuelan police kick dogs. Okay. Actually, no, it's a picture from Greece, where they clearly go around kicking dogs a lot more than they do in Venezuela. And then down here, the collapse and decline of the healthcare services. Look at these babies. We have Barrio Dentro. This was an astonishing program. And look, now you've got babies in baskets. It's a photograph from Honduras. Sadly and unfortunately, so many of these images regurgitated by the mainstream news. But the big thing here is that the opposition have no popular connection. And going back to the keynote we had on the first day, when Keith was talking about counter-revolution as representing popular aspiration, Venezuela's opposition represent no aspiration of the popular sectors, and I discuss this in my article in NACLA. So finally, my constructively two-minute critical perspective. We have enormous benefits to learn from what happened in Venezuela. This was a real beacon of progressive change. It was a landmark period, transformative impact and provider of rights that have never previously been acknowledged on the continent. Very important in terms of pushing back the neoliberal agenda, and really created for the first time in Latin America after coups and interventions the idea another world is possible. But here's the problems: utter ideological flux and incoherence. If you're going to nationalise everything in the economy, can you afford it? And who runs it? Is it the workers or is it the state? That was never decided. Continued under-theorisation of the state itself, overly reliant and commodity-driven. What Venezuela has actually created is a new elite, the so-called bully bourgeoisie, who are those people who have benefited from the distribution of these illicit subsidised dollars. Massive policy dysfunction, as I think I mentioned before, retention of regressive subsidies, and when you're going to go around nationalising Venezuela now has 562 state-owned enterprises, but you don't have the money to invest in them, that results in electricity shortages, water shortages, blackouts and power failures. And you have no money for capital reinvestment and find yourself in international arbitration. Politically, no institutionalisation of initiatives, corruption as an ongoing problem, this parallelism, as I pointed out. Community councils really never gained the traction that was necessary or vital, constantly in conflict with the ruling PSUV. And I would say at the heart of policy dysfunction has been the constant turning over of ministerial offices. If you want to know why Venezuela has such outrageous levels of crime and violence, in my view, it was because during 15 years, 13 years of the Chavez presidency, we had 11 different interior ministers. You really cannot get policy going in that context. And no M&E, as I was talking, monitoring evaluation. And I think the biggest tragedy is this lack of space for dissent and critical discussion. There is now a very high reliance on the role of the military in maintaining the government's in power. The military hold key positions in the government. They hold key positions in the economy. They have their own radio station, their own investment arm. But I think the real problem for the Venezuelan revolution, the Bolivarian revolution, is that it missed two important things. Generational change. Okay? It's now nearly 20 years since Chavez was elected. And there's a whole new generation of young people who've come through who don't remember the old punto fijo period. Or the salience of the Bolivarian revolution. And the other aspect here is the influence of the diaspora. Hugely underestimated by the government, profoundly influential overseas. And my final two points, and I end this... I think that if you are to have a process of revolutionary change, the rule of law does matter. I just don't find it helpful that Venezuela has recreated a judicial system, but really there is no functioning rule of law in the country. And in particular, I would argue that Venezuela and its opposition have frozen the country. And important progress in important areas of rights have been completely bypassed. Venezuela is so far behind the curve on LGBT rights that it's really ranked up there with some of the most homophobic countries in the world. On issues such as women's rights and gender rights, there has still been no process on the effective legalisation of abortion. So as a result of this, one of the leading causes of female mortality in Venezuela is as a result of access to unsafe abortions. I'll leave you with the thought that actually, and I think the way history may judge this is that tragically, the reality is the Fifth Republic was very similar to the Fourth Republic. And just as the Fifth Republic had its Petro Caribe, the Fourth Republic had the San Jose oil exchange. There was Tercer Mundismo under Carlos Andrés Pérez. The FARC always had an unofficial embassy in Venezuela before Chavez even came to power. And there's always been close relations with Iran. So ultimately, I think what we have in Venezuela is just a return, sadly and unfortunately, to the zero-sum game. And I'm going to run now before you all start getting really cross and angry with me, but that is unfortunately where I would have to conclude. And I'm sorry to overrun.
Wonderful presentation, thought-provoking in many, many different ways. And I have to say that you're going to miss your flight tomorrow. I'm going to kidnap you, so because you can teach that section for my South America since 1945 course next semester, because it's absolutely great. This overview trying to show all the complexity of the situation. So we're going to go now. We have 15 minutes. So what we're going to do, I'm going to ask you to keep your questions concise and brief so we can take as many as possible. So we're going to take two or three questions each time, then Julia Glanska will go to the next one. So we'll start here.
Hi, my name is Jeremiah. I thoroughly enjoyed your presentation. I'm actually very happy because I'm also presenting from Venezuela later, and you didn't cover everything I'm going to cover, so there's some space.
I left that space for you on purpose.
Yeah, thank you very much. I liked your presentation, but I had some problems. And I had some problems also with your Left Review article, because in your analysis, you did a very good analysis of what's going on in the state and on the state level. But I think one of the key things that you're missing is where are the masses in Venezuela? And you talk about the community councils, you talked about the misiones, you talked about other things, but one of the biggest developments in Venezuela is precisely the emergence of the masses and how the mass political collective action has completely changed Venezuela. And I would argue, in fact, Venezuela was one of the originary neoliberal revolts, because I would argue it started with the Caracaso, and that it consistent even before Chavez had emerged, that there was a revolutionary upsurge in Venezuela. So where are the masses and the role of the masses in this, and especially you can see the upsurge of the mass support again for the revolution through the Constituent Assembly and the processes that the Constituent Assembly has started. So I'll let someone else answer.
I think it was a very good presentation. I'd like to hear your views on the new Constituent Assembly and the vote for the Constituent Assembly. And I'd like to know what has happened. I'm basing myself on Elder's article in the Historical Materialism and the class situation there, because Elmer argues that the upper bourgeoisie were always against the new regime, the petty bourgeoisie, that Chavez and Maduro worked with the petty bourgeoisie, and what has happened now? Has the revolution swung over to the masses and working class, or are they still playing footsie with the bourgeoisie?
In the interest of time, and Jeremy, I'll come to your panel so we can talk about this. Actually, my question to you is, where are the masses? Because I don't see the masses in the senior echelons of the ruling PSUV. I don't see the masses in the government. I don't see the popular sectors in the government. And actually, I don't really see many of the so-called masses in candidacies for state governorship or in the Constituent Assembly. What we have instead seen is the constant parachuting in and recycling of a key body of elites. So my question actually back to you is, you tell me, where are the masses? On the new Constituent Assembly, I had a bit of a discussion with Alan about this yesterday. I think there was nothing wrong with the Bolivarian Constitution of 2000, apart from the fact it wasn't implemented. And actually, it was quite a feasible, viable, and good document, and actually it should have been about institutionalizing the Constitution. So I think that the elections for the Constituent Assembly that were held in July were more of a defence mechanism by the government against this really strengthening opposition movement now. And what was problematic is that the government delayed the regional elections that should have been held in December 2015 on the basis that the Conseil National Electoral, the electoral administration, didn't have the full capacity to administer these elections. So, to international outrage and, you know, criticism from moderate leftist Chavistas, they cancelled those elections, and yet 6 months later they seem to have acquired the capacity to hold elections for a National Constituent Assembly. So I'm not a big fan of the Constituent Assembly process. It's very unclear to me what the Constituent Assembly is supposed to be doing. And the big tragedy of all of this, Chavez loved elections, okay? If Chavez could have an election, he'd have one every week. Maduro is not a fan of elections, and I think that's the biggest differentiation between the two. Are they playing footsie with the economic elite? I think they did do right through until the coup attempt, and then, as I tried to show in the slides, they tried to create a new economic elite. And this is exactly what's happened with the so-called boli bourgeoisie, those who are getting access to the bolivars. They have created a new class structure in Venezuela. Instead of reducing the power of the economic elite, they've actually created a new one. And that's Steve's argument as well, actually, in his historical materialism argument.
Well, it's been a long time, Julia. we started the Venezuela Information Centre in London when? 2005, I think it was.
2003, actually, with the coup.
2003. You'll be surprised to hear I agree with most of what you said. But I want to pose one simple question. Is it over? And I want to argue it's not over till it's over. And I secondly want to ask you to say what you think the alternative would be. Because there are a whole series of features what's now happening in Venezuela and Latin America that lead me to believe the alternative is so horrific. Mm-hmm. It not only cannot not be allowed to happen, but it will not happen, right? You mentioned the opposition. What you didn't mention is the extraordinary racist hatred of the opposition for Chavez. You know, he's portrayed as a monkey, as a black guy, you know, whatever. And the extraordinary violence. I mean, if we had had Pérez Pereira here, he would have shown pictures of kids being doused in petrol and burned alive by the opposition. And the people who have died in Venezuela are Chavistas or innocent young kids. And why were they burned? Because they were brown. Because they were brown and wearing red shirts. This is an extraordinary level of hatred and violence. So will the masses allow that to happen? And will the army allow that to happen? Only if there is an extreme level of civil war. And the third factor is the Bolivarian army. I mean, when we went for the first time in March, I was astonished at two things. At the level of openness to discourse, but maybe that's because of the people we were talking to, but all the institutions we took us to, and you've helped explain this, were military. Went to the military academy, went to the 4F barracks, and to the central barracks. And there's obviously the Bolivarian tradition of the army for a very long time. What you've said about the Chavez coup that doesn't surprise me. It's not the Chilean army. It's not the Argentine. It's not the Colombian. It's not the US army. So that provided the masses create the institutions, which is perfectly possible, the paralysis of the MSU, you know, is preventing. There will be a bloody confrontation, both because of the horrific character of the opposition and because you can't just have a coup. You can't just have there's no military to take over. Right. Now, then, it's very simple. The counter-revolution generates revolution. I mean, Chavez, or the lesson of why I have not given up hope is that, as Chavez says, that the revolution thrives on the counter-revolution. I'm not talking about any confidence in the leadership, but I do have confidence in the Venezuelan masses. And the creativity of the Venezuelan masses is the permanent feature of the revolutionary process. They were what drove the move to socialism in the 21st century. So I would say I would not give up, first of all, because what will happen if we do give up is so awful. But secondly, because I've not lost faith in the creativity of the masses. And finally, America now has nothing to offer. Before, it,
that the elite, the opposition parties, are only explained by their parasitic relation to the United States. And I thought it was very interesting that, you know, Temer is not having an easy time in Brazil. And all the governments of Latin America that were supposed to be taken over with this right-wing revolution all uttered declarations against Trump saying we're going to have an American military intervention. That's a change. That's a change. Why are they doing this? Because they're getting used to the fact that the US is useless and it's been in decline for 20 bloody years. It's got nothing to offer. And I would say about China, for instance, we need to have a discussion with the Chinese about this, and we are. And they're very conscious of it, and they don't know what to do. But we need to have a very open discussion with them, because they have a responsibility. What do they do with this 63 billion? If it's a socialist country, they shouldn't just be saying, give us our money. They should be saying, as they are to many other countries of the world, let us partner in a way that genuinely solves the real problem. They never invested in the country. They never used the oil surplus to invest and reconstruct. And that's a problem of all Latin America, not just Venezuela. So again, the alternative is so horrible because it's a collapse of all Latin American attempts at independence from the USA.
Yeah, I'll just while you're moving the microphone, I'll just come back on Alan. I agree with you, Alan, and I think, you know, I mean, this is why this last slide here is that I still remain committed to the fact that you cannot have US intervention or any form of intervention in Venezuela. But again, it's back to my point that we also need to have space for critical assessment of what's going on. I mean, that's my, because every time we get to the point of a critical discussion on Venezuela, there's some, it's almost like the US knows it's a critical opportunity for discussion, and they do something that makes everybody say, put aside the discussion, we need to focus on unity against the US. And that's
the fact that Venezuela wanted to send here a critic of the regime demonstrates that there is an openness to have that discussion and to be, that's where I'm
given the language.
So just going back to Alan's point, I do think that this is why I'm saying this is particularly perilous, because I do think Venezuela, the situation is really quite acute, and if there are what the opposition presents, I think, is going to be horrendous. It's horrific. I actually think the reason why this is such a perilous moment is we are looking at the possibility of major civil conflict and bloodshed in the country. And this is not unconnected to the fragility of the peace process in neighbouring Colombia. I agree with everything you say about the violence of the opposition. I'll be writing about this, and I have tried to write about this, and I'll be writing about it more. People are being used as cannon fodder by the opposition, and this was a point made in a workshop I went to yesterday with Barbara Falk. The use of young people and cannon fodder social media, I agree with you 100%. Just on the military, my concern, however, is what is the cost of the military's loyalty to the revolution? That is my concern. And that's why, you know, we're getting to a point where it's either the military or the popular sectors, and I think that that cleavage is becoming increasingly incompatible.
That introduces my question. I have hope because of the masses of poor people in Colombia, tempered by the absence of any revolutionary leadership that I can see.
In Venezuela?
In Venezuela. I'm talking about Venezuela. And I doubt any good possible outcome precisely because of the corruption of the military. At some point, the military is going to divide. Maduro has been buying the loyalty of the military. They have more generals than any other country in the world. Every other tribe is a general now. And the military is the question. So my question to you is, what is your assessment of the situation in the Venezuelan military now?
Is that the last question? The situation in the Venezuelan military, I would say, is very difficult to discern. And when we had our brief chat the other day, I was saying it was like Kremlinology. I mean, it's very difficult to know what's going on. It seems to be the case, and some of the concerns I have is claims that what is happening is that there is disaffection amongst the lower ranks of the military, the junior sectors, against the privilege of the senior ranks, which is in essence back to where we were in 1992. Is that a fire alarm or is it just an out-of-control moment? So I think the real worry is that the military is on side currently, but is it on side because of the benefits that it's gaining and the the financial aspects that it's benefiting from, and that is the real concern. But clearly the strategy of the opposition is to put the military and the security sector more broadly under such intense pressure with these violent protests and mobilizations that they are trying to separate the military from the government. But incidentally, I would argue the US sanctions now on senior members of the Venezuelan military actually make the domestic opposition's chance of creating this rupture less likely. This is the irony, is there's the contradictions in that policy, because the US sanctions are actually welding the government and the military closer together rather than separating them. So the military, I think, will stay with this process because they have a lot to lose from regime change, but sentiment in the lower ranks seems to be very, very problematic.
Hi, I would like to draw you out on 2 points. Thank you very much for your presentation. I think you mentioned briefly about Venezuela's relationship with Cuba, but I think what you did not say was that by coming to power, you know, Venezuela also broke Cuba's isolation in the Western Hemisphere, because Cuba and the Cuban Revolution was pretty isolated before Chavez came to power, and I think it basically rejuvenated the Cuban Revolution. I think that's one of the achievements of the Bolivarian Revolution. Secondly, you have not really talked about the role of the left opposition to Chavez. I mean, for example, where is the Venezuelan Communist Party, and is it part of the reason why what is happening in Venezuela is because, you said that populism is perhaps not the best way to explain Chavez, but maybe it is the best way because, and I'm going to ask you, is what is happening in Venezuela because there is no left alternative like the Communist Party, or is it because it was mostly beholden to the charisma of Chavez himself, and perhaps, Maduro it does not possess that kind of charisma and the folksy populist nature which had such a powerful impact not only in Venezuela but in the rest of the region. Thank you.
On Cuba, and yes, I agree, it broke Cuba's isolation, and that was why Venezuela was such a big threat and why the US was so proactive. And this Oil for Doctors program has been absolutely phenomenal. And I think in the UNRWSP paper I talk about, that really needs to be globally expanded, because what Cuba has provided in terms of medical services is astonishing. But where is Cuba now that the Venezuelan oil price has collapsed? Where is Cuba now that Venezuela's debt is at unpayable levels? And it's back to this, have we created new chains of, core and periphery and dependency? And because Cuba now is completely screwed because Venezuela is also financially in such acute difficulty. So yes, it certainly helped Cuba out of its political isolation and it helped Cuba out of its economic isolation. But that now has proved to be as fragile and vulnerable as the Bolivarian Revolution itself. The left alternative, there was a left, the Communist Party of Venezuela, very influential figures within the early Chavista movement came from the Communist Party of Venezuela, but there was growing disaffection. The Communist Party, I think, now is in the opposition movement. The opposition movement goes from like the far left to the far right. La Causa Aérea is in the opposition movement now as well. The left alternative, I think we saw many of the left who were in the initial Pueblo Patriotico, which was the great patriotic coalition, became so disaffected as the circle of influence diminished, and particularly during the period of Maduro, we've seen key people, Jorge Giordani, who is the kind of great economic influence over Chavez, Giordani's gone. You've got Bernardo Alvarez, who sadly was such an immense figure and who passed away last year. But you've seen great swathes of people leave this process because they've not been listened to or because they've been essentially forced out of the process. And really, that is kind of like the revolutionary circle has just diminished and diminished. And where you had the left previously, I would argue that's now been replaced by the military, led by people like Diosdado Cabello.
Such a brilliant presentation, so many questions. I'm just going to ask two very quickly at random. Could you please say a few words about the connection to the Colombian peace process and how that factors into all this? And secondly, you talked about how Chavez sought to drive up the price of oil. How exactly did he do that?
Okay. On the price of oil, previously Venezuela had been a notorious quota buster in OPEC. And much like Saudi Arabia, Venezuela was a very important supplier of a strategically important 15% of oil to the United States. And interestingly, during the Chavez government, Venezuelan economic ties with the US, despite the rhetoric, actually deepened. Venezuela's bilateral trading ties became stronger and stronger with the US. A big failure, I would argue, is that Venezuela has oil in the ground in Venezuela. Where are Venezuela's refining facilities? They're in the United States of America. It's very, very difficult to have economic sovereignty when all of your refining facilities are in Citgo in the United States, and that is the current vulnerability Venezuela has right now. So what Venezuela did was it stopped quota busting to try and lift the price of oil. The problem has always been the Saudis have been the big quota busters in OPEC. The more oil they produce, the more it brings the price down. But the other big challenge that Venezuela also faced was that the US also changed its energy policy in this conversation we were having the other day. Fracking, the exploitation of Canadian tar sands, this has transformed the energy market, so the demand for Venezuelan oil has slumped. But it was really by trying to work with OPEC countries, and this was Ali Rodriguez, Bernard Momma, trying to work with OPEC states to agree output quotas across OPEC states and also the NOPEC countries in order that quota busting didn't drag the price of oil down. Does that make sense? In terms of the Colombian peace process, I think the big concern right now is that the Colombian peace process is showing a lot of fragility. Many people were advising the United Nations that the minute the FARC lays down its weapons and disarms, you are going to have a security vacuum. And if you do not attend to that security vacuum, that will then be moved into by right-wing paramilitaries and criminal organizations. And that's really the situation that that Colombia is facing right now. And they were warned, right? So this is, you know, very negligent. But the concern is that, A, if there is the overthrow of Maduro, and this in a way, Alan, links back to your point, there has been the deliberate arming of Venezuelan citizens, as we know, to defend the revolution, which when you live in the world's third highest homicide rate country, arming civilians, you know, it's all kind of spinning. So the big problem really is going to be that if Maduro was overthrown, if the opposition come to power, okay, just the demonstration effect that it's legitimate to overthrow the government makes it legitimate in my view, or would make it legitimate in my view, for then the Chavistas in opposition to themselves try and overthrow through the use of force. Because why shouldn't they, if that was how the opposition came to power? We'd have a completely illegitimate opposition government, which would be the concern of stability going forward. But my worry would be that left-wing discontent and disempowering in Venezuela has the potential to link with increasing frustration by the FARC at the peace process in Colombia, the wavering of the US over its commitments, and the opposition of people like Uribe and this very right-wing backlash in Colombia. If we see the FARC pushed back to a form of insurgency at the same time as we see the Venezuelan government overthrown, there are manifest implications here in terms of the potential for transandean linkages, insurgency linkages on the left, but also on the right, and these pan-Andean linkages of the right, also the right-wing paramilitaries, should not be underestimated. But I'll leave you with one key point on this, which was, at the moment, Colombia, as a drug policy friend, Colombia's coca cultivation has soared, okay, this year, for multiple reasons. And this is all mainly along the border with Venezuela. And so the big criticism in UK policy circles and US policy circles is that this is Venezuela's fault. Okay? Venezuela is a narco regime and has been decertified. Okay? All of this usual rhetoric. And yet the reality is Colombia is the coca producer and producing more cocaine. So the Venezuela is being blamed for the economic insecurity which the Colombian peace process has created for coca cultivators in that country. So there are all kinds of ramifications for Colombia's peace process, but I would be very concerned about the circulation and the illicit trade in oil, in drugs, in guns, and in cross-border transfers of paramilitaries and left-wing militias.
Well, we have to finish now. Thank you very much.
Thank you.